followed by 3 bits of inter-frame spacing IFS to provide sufficient spacing between next frame. Now if you compare this with 29-bit identifier, you will see minor differences compared to 11-bit. Let's have a look into frame and message terminology before starting the actual topic. What's message? Message is the total content that one ECU wants to send to other ECU. So the ECUs use CAN format and sends it across. When this message is put in the format and sent, it's a CAN frame which is transmitted now. So CAN frame is a chunk or whole message sent in CAN frame format. With this understanding, let's look into the CAN frame format. CAN frame format is the rule or understanding by which messages are transmitted in the network. Similar to how English language has different grammatical rules that has to be followed to convey the message in English, similar to this, CAN messages have a format by which the ECUs interact with each other in the network. There are two different message formats: standard or base frame format and extended frame format. Only difference between these two formats is that CAN base format supports 11-bit identifier, CAN extended frame format supports 29-bit identifier. What could be the scenario that led to the development of 11 and 29-bit identifiers? To answer this question, let's look into the values that could be held in these identifiers. For 11-bit identifier, the identifier value ranges from 0 to 2047 values, while for 29-bit identifier, the value ranges from 0 to 536,870,911 values. So going with 29-bit identifier does increase the load of CAN by 18 bits compared to 11-bit identifier, but there is a primary advantage of moving to 29-bit identifier. OEMs don't have to worry on the shortage of the identifier for ECUs on CAN, as there are plenty of identifier number compared to 11-bit identifier now. For example, if there are 3000 ECUs to be identified in all variants of different cars that they manufacture, then 11-bit identifier would find it hard to provide unique identifier to each ECU, while 29-bit would suffice the job. Now let's look into the format. For 11-bit identifier, we have start of the frame bit, which obviously, as the name implies, indicates the start. Then we have 11-bit identifier, which identifies the ECU, followed by RTR, which is remote transmission request. This bit, as we will see it later, is used to define if the frame is meant for remote transmission or actual data transmission. When it's dominant, it's for data transmission, and when it's recessive, it's for remote transmission. Then we have IDE, identifier extension bit, which differentiates if this is a 11-bit or 29-bit identifier frame. So for 11-bit, it shall be set to dominant, and for 29-bit, it shall be sent to recessive. Then there is a reserve bit, which is actually set to dominant, followed by DLC, data length code, which defines the length of the data sent in the frame. The maximum size of DLC is 4 bytes. Then we have data field, which actually contains the data that's being transmitted. The length of the data field is 8 bytes, which is then followed by the CRC of 15-bit, which contains the cyclic redundancy check calculated on the data. And then we have the CRC delimiter, which, as the name implies, sets the boundary for the CRC, followed by acknowledgement slot, ACK slot, which is set by transmitter to recessive, while receiver shall set it to dominant once it's received the data. followed by acknowledgement delimiter, which again similar to CRC delimiter is meant to create a boundary for acknowledgement, followed by end of frame, which is 7 bits of receive state transmitted to create an end for the CAN frame entirely, followed by 3 bits of inter-frame spacing IFS to provide sufficient spacing between next frame. Now if you compare this with 29-bit identifier, you will see minor differences compared to 11-bit. There are two identifier fields, identifier A with 11 bits and identifier B with 18 bits here. There's a remote transmission request is then shifted below identifier B, and substitute remote request is added below identifier A, which obviously is always set to receive. IDE will be set to 1 as its 29-bit identifier now, and there are two reserve bits added after remote transmit request bit. Rest of the fields are more or less the same for the 29-bit identifier. So what type of frames do we have in CAN? Depending on the content of the frame, the CAN frame can be classified into data frame, remote frame, error frame, and overload frame. Let's look into each one of them in detail. Data frame. Data frame is a frame that contains the data for transmission. This is the normal frame which gets transmitted in the CAN network. Remote frame. Remote frame is a frame that is transmitted by a receiving ECU to the transmitting ECU. RTR bit is set recessive and there is no data field in this frame. So the DLC will be the length of requested message and not the transmitted message. Error frame. Error frame is a special frame which is transmitted whenever there is an error in the transmission. The frame consists of first field, which is superposition of error flags, which is 6 to 12 dominant or receive bits contributed from different ECUs, followed by second field, which is the error delimiter consisting of 8 receive bits. Overload frame. The overload frame is a frame which is sent when there is a delay required by a receiver while receiving frames from other ECU. The frame is usually sent after the IFS, that's inter-frame spacing, to inform the transmitter of delay through overflow frame. Similar to error frame, the frame consists of first field of 6 dominant bits, followed by second field, which is the overflow delimiter consisting of 8 receive bits. Before we look into CAN error types, let's have a look into the bit stuffing concept. Bit stuffing is used to synchronize the message transmission, and it's also like a transmission rule which has to be followed by every ECU in the network, so that there is a differentiation whenever continuous bits of same value are transmitted. What do I mean by that? Basically, bit stuffing comes into picture when 5 dominant or 5 receive bits are transmitted continuously. So if a transmission frame contains 5 continuous dominant bit, then a receive bit is stuffed after, so that there is an evidence that the line is not sticking to dominant or receive value by default. With this understanding, let's look into the CAN error. CAN protocol specifies 5 CAN error types: bit error, bit stuffing error, form error, acknowledgement error, and CRC error. Bit error. Bit error is identified by transmitter ECU when it transmits dominate or receive bit and observes the opposite logical level on the CAN network. Bit stuff error. Bit stuff error is identified by a receiver ECU when it detects 6 continuous bit of same logic, either dominant or receive, without a bit stuff. Data which is checked in this is from the start of the bit frame to the CRC. Form error. Form error is identified by receiver ECU when there is invalid logical level present in SOF or EOF field or acknowledgement or CRC delimiter field. Since these fields have predefined value, they cannot be deviated from that. Acknowledgement error. Acknowledgement error is identified by transmitter ECU when ECU transmits the CAN message but acknowledgement slot is not made dominant by receiver ECU. CRC error. CRC error is identified by receiver ECU when CRC calculated by receiver doesn't match with the CRC transmitted in the message. With this, we have touched upon frame format, types of frame, and the CAN errors. In the next session, we will look a bit deeper into CAN node states and error flag.